Right, scalpel. Are you looking at me, guy?
We're losing adrenaline now.
You'll never amount to anything, Pat.
Everybody clear. You scum.
We've lost him.
They say that all good things must come to an end. Though, strictly speaking, that's not true. El Dorado, scavengers, and the Second World War, they all ended and they were cack. Today, however, we're packing our smalls as this groundbreaking fifth series of Gamesmaster grinds to a halt. Today, though, we'll endeavour to pump so much fun up your arteries that the following Gamesmaster 3 months will leave your emotions intact. Starting with today's news.
Just for a laugh, we thought we'd finish the series with an exclusive look at some of the biggest games in the pantline, and of course the place they'll be appearing first is in the arcades. Fans of the combo are in for a chop-licking treat later in the year when Killer Instinct 2 makes its way arcade-wards. The sequel features new characters like the spiky brief-wearing Tusk, and old characters have had a little bit of a makeover, with Orchid having more bouffant hair. The gameplay has been improved too. Extra moves include Sableworth's somersault kick, and Orchid has an updated helicopter move. The biggest innovation though is a special move feature underneath the energy bar that rewards attacking play with some extra moves. But of course, it wouldn't be Killer Instinct without the combos, and the game certainly delivers on this count. This is an early version of the game, and there's a wee bit of a glitch when the action speeds up, but cop a feel of new character Kim's devastating 49-hit combo.
Easy go.
Arcade giant Namco are putting the finishing touches to two new titles, the Virtua Cop-style shoot-em-up Time Crisis, featuring the innovative dodge out of the way of flying bullets function, and their Soul Edge, the first polygon beat-em-up since last week. Sega, meanwhile, are filling the gap before Virtua Cop 3 with Fighting Vipers, a beat-em-up involving young fashion victims wielding guitars and skateboards, slugging it out in a cage-like arena. But Sega's biggest title of 1996 looks set to be Manx TT, which does for motorbikes what Genghis Khan did for fights. Perched astride an alarmingly convincing articulated bike, players race around an exact replica of the Isle of Man's famous race course. All of these games will be appearing in arcades over the next few months and on home versions by the end of the year, which is December for stupid people.
Now, because it's the final show, we don't want any namby-pamby soft celebrity guests coming on. Instead, we're upping the quotient of rock-hard hairy blokeness as we welcome Iron Maiden's own axeman, Yannick Gers. We've ever had in heaven, well, I have to say.
Rock and roller.
Now listen, yeah, Yannick, first of all, you've taken a break just now from your world tour that you're on. Is there still a large groupie element these days?
Large groupies?
Large groupies even, that are like 20 stone?
I think the groupies are rather large, yeah.
We don't get groupies on this show. I don't get any at all.
We've got two beautiful angels.
Well, exactly, I don't need them. That's very well pointed out, Yannick. I was nearly in trouble there from the girls. And the other thing is, I always wanted to be a rock and roll star, but I never had the hair. You know?
Well, you could grow it.
If I had like 20 years to kill, then I might be able to get it to your epic proportions there. Why is it then that so many proper rock stars have long hair?
Probably because in normal society you've got to cut your hair and fit in. Yeah. So when you get the chance not to fit in, it's good to do something a little bit different.
And never gets caught in the guitar strings or anything like that?
Yeah, I've been caught a few times. Just snip them bits off and carry on.
Well, listen, we would have had Yannick on anyway because he is such a dead-hard bloke and we like that on the show. But there is another special reason, and that is our final event of the series, which we are calling Blokes Who Sweat Rock and Roll.
guffaw, if you will, but the most original and addictive game we've played all year is Quest for Fame, a rock and roll adventure that requires you to get to grips with the absurd yet strangely appealing virtual guitar, which plugs directly into your PC.
Hey, that ain't the kid with the guitar!
Like life itself, the action begins in your bedroom where you begin to play along to your favourite rock anthems. The bar at the bottom of the screen shows the actual guitar strokes of the song, and the object is to match them with your virtual guitar as best you can. The score on the right of the bar shows how well you're doing. Assuming you've got what it takes, it won't be long before your neighbour arrives with the kind of news every would-be guitar hero longs to hear.
Woo! Man, we might have a gig! We're gonna learn some new tunes tonight at the garage, so be there!
All right! Let's get into it.
If the rehearsal goes well, that very night, we'll see you and your brain-dead buddies preparing to step on stage at local rock and roll sleaze pit, the Roadkill.
Hey, all right, come on in, dudes.
Let's blow the roof off this place.
Are you ready?
Crank it up.
Your performance at the Roadkill is reflected in the reaction of the punters. When they stand still, you're making a mess of things. But when you're playing well, you'll soon have the crowd performing the kind of dance moves only Californians are capable of.
Our virtual virtuoso must play with sufficient skill to inspire at least 6 members of the audience to strut their stuff in front of the stage by the end of the song. Only if 6 people are grooving when the final chord is played, will he earn the joystick?
And that's why Yannick is here. We've played the game up till the club level. He has to play the song Eat the Rich well enough to get 6 punters up and dancing. Help me out as a man who's no stranger to strapping on huge big guitars. Kirk Ewan, Kirk, any tips for Yannick?
Yannick's going back to his roots here, playing some sleazy LA club, something which you're no doubt familiar with, Dominic. He's got 2 choices, basically. He can either follow the notes as they appear at the bottom of the screen, or he can just kind of free-form, and I'm sure it'll sound good anyway.
But maybe not necessarily points-wise, he won't do well that way.
Well, no, he won't do well that way, but maybe he won't care.
Let's not take anything away from the man.
No, he's...
At this stage. OK, then, so Yannick has to have 6 people up and dancing by the end of the song, and the song is Aerosmith's Eat the Rich. Take it away, Yannick. Okay, at the bottom of the screen, you can see those bars here. It's coming in now. You can hear them there. Not a terribly good start, Kirk. He's missing a couple of beats.
Yeah, he certainly is, and I don't think the guys in Iron Maiden would be terribly happy if he was playing like that.
Oh, Fat Boy's dancing, though. Good. That's one boy dancing.
Yeah, you've got a fat bloke dancing in the audience.
That was you, Kirk.
That wasn't actually me, Dominic. I think you'll find that something that was much fatter than you, possibly related to you.
Okay. The band are looking quite happy. You can see the manager's face in the bottom left-hand corner, though. He's not too happy.
He is.
And indeed...
Again, quick! We gotta get it right!
First attempt ends in failure, though. Of course, we are gonna give him another couple of chances. Here he goes again.
I like that start, Kirk. You like that, do you?
It's cool.
It's cool, but I think he's done.
Okay. We can see a score of 754. Oh, we've got 4 people dancing now, actually. 1 couple, 1 solo man, 1 solo girl. Maybe Fat Bloke will get together with that girl towards the end.
I don't know. I mean, it is actually like the sort of club that River Phoenix would have died of boredom in, I would say.
Quite possibly, Kirk. Still 4 people dancing. A couple of people looking as if they might want to, but they're not quite tempted yet. Score about 750. Generally a good score, about 850 upwards is a good score on this. He's hitting those beats well, though, Kirk.
He seems to be doing quite well, actually, this time. Dominic, manager's face is quite happy in the bottom left. The score is staying fairly consistent. You've got your sort of random LA people grooving away in the background there. I think he's doing pretty well.
And the band are getting quite into it. Trying to fashion victims, that they are. But we still need 2 more. It scores up. No, this is getting good. It scores up to the high 800s now. We want 6 of those people dancing before the end of the song. Is that much? Oh, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Oh, they're all dancing. It's a dance frenzy here for Yannick Gers. That's it. We might as well continue to the end of the song anyway. He's been fantastic, O'Connor.
He is doing fantastic. He might even be considered leaving Iron Maiden and going and joining this gang if that's... the two
Yes, buttons. A couple of people have stopped dancing. Remember, they have to be dancing still by the end of the song. A little bloke, random bloke at the front there dancing. I don't know quite where he's come from.
Ha-ha, rock and roll.
Yeah,
She's coming over here.
She's trying on a little bit, kind of thing.
I think that's actually to us.
Yes.
Not yet. Oh, they're all dancing again. Look at those two blokes by the pool table. I don't know quite what they're doing.
That's slam dance. That used to be fashionable in Marseille.
A long, long time ago. His score is up. Oh, it's just over 900, but it's just dropped back down slightly. And I don't think it's too much longer, this song, so he's going to keep playing a little bit more and he'll do it, but he's playing fantastically well. Dropped a little bit on the dance for there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And random block.
Still there. He's the only one that seems to actually have moved up to the front. Everyone else has been a bit cool about it. You know, it's the LA way. You hang back, you let the band do their thing.
They are, and again, Fat Block's showing a lot of energy there. He hasn't stopped yet.
Well, he kind of needs to lose a bit of that weight anyway.
He does need to do worse. It's a special calorie control dance. He's doing that. That's it. That's the end of the song. The six people are dancing there like they were earlier on. It's fantastic. Yannick Gers has done the challenge.
You're really on tonight, bud.
Well done, Yannick, mate.
Now, listen, it was at the start, things went a little bit wrong. What were some of the problems that you were having?
Well, it was an Aerosmith song, and I was playing an Iron Maiden tune, so it didn't work.
Bound to be problems there, mixing the two.
Yeah.
But in the end, it was fine. What was it like then, playing in that small club compared to like playing in the stadiums you're playing now, and the atmosphere of our fantastic heaven?
I think if whoever buys this plays in the club, and then hopefully they get to the stadium and see the difference itself.
So you think this could well coax the Iron Maiden Axemen of tomorrow?
Definitely, definitely. It's a coaxer.
Well, thanks so much for coming on indeed, Yannick. It's been great to have you on, and it means the winner of our special Blokes Who Sweat Rock and Roll Games Master Golden Joystick, Yannick Gers. And while Yannick goes off for a quick shot back inside, we'll take a look at today's reviews.
First up, run around attempting to save the lives of 8 forms of rare butterflies using only a copy of Umberto Eco's Name of the Rose. Yes, you guessed it. It's Assault Rigs on the PlayStation.
It's a bit of a battle tank game. You drive around in a texture map tank, shooting baddies that look like they've come straight out of Star Fox on the Super Nintendo. And the whole thing lacks imagination and lacks polish. I found it very boring. What did you think, Rick?
Well, I think there is some gameplay hidden in its shabby exterior. It looks terrible, but it kind of plays okay. If you link two PlayStations together, you have a two-player mode where you can both shoot each other.
It's all just a thin veil over a game that is sadly lacking in any excitement. I'm not impressed, and I wouldn't encourage anyone to go out and buy this without trying it first in the shop.
Like Eddie Izzard, the X-Men is a very overrated comic, but they do have their own game on the Saturn, while Eddie Izzard doesn't.
X-Men.
You have all the characters from all the X-Men comics, and they just go hell for leather against each other. But it's a 2D beat-em-up, which I'm not normally that keen on, so let's see what Dave, the beat-em-up expert, really thinks.
There's the capacity for big combos. There are huge special moves. It reminds me a bit of Turtles Tournament Fighters on the SNES in its quirkiness, but it's a lot faster and a lot more exciting. This is worth checking out. This is cartoon scrapping at its best.
You win.
Well, that's part one over, but part two is more packed than a fat bloke sandwich. So we're going to go to our last commercial break of the series, and remember, this is the final chance you'll have to say, oh my God, aren't these adverts fantastic? Games Master of the series. It's a sad occasion. So amidst near tragic torrents of tears, let's go over to Games Master for the final challenge.
Since this is our final challenge, I have come up with something a little special. The awesome arcade driving game, Rave Racer. Players have 2 laps to burn the rubber as they speed their way around the mountain track. As usual, with 2-player driving games, we'll be swapping between the viewpoints of each contestant to keep up with the action, which I expect to be fast and furious. Right then, let's hit the gas.
And here to burn rubber like there's no tomorrow, and bearing in mind this is our last show for Channel 4 anyway, there is no televisual tomorrow, please welcome Amar Ashraf and Cecil Dyer. Now, Emma, you're obviously quite a big bloke. I'm not going to take too much mick out of you. You study fashion.
That's right.
Yeah. And so give me a quick appraisal.
Well, it's not bad. It's a bit bland.
Bland, you reckon?
Yeah.
I prefer the word classic, do you know, I think?
Just about.
Nice cut. Tapered legs in the bottom.
It shows off those skinny legs of yours, yeah.
Does it?
Yeah.
All right, fine. I might give you a kick in, actually, if you're not careful. Emma, not that I'd fancy my chances much, of course, to be honest. I am bald and wear glasses. He is large and muscle-bound. Cecil, now you don't study fashion, obviously, but you do cook.
Yeah, I do.
Uh-huh. What kind of stuff do you cook?
Caribbean dishes, English dishes, uh-huh. Anything you want, really.
Do you eat quite a lot then?
Yeah, quite a bit, as you can see from the stomach.
That's not for me to say, Cecil. And you cut hair?
Yeah, I can cut hair as well.
Do you cut your own hair? I just wonder whether you maybe hid it deliberately.
No, I don't cut my own hair, and I didn't cut yours either, don't
you? No, you didn't? Do you like my hair?
Yeah, it's very good.
Yeah? Could you do anything different with it, do you think?
Just a little bit here and there.
A little bit of hair here and there would be fantastic, actually. Pretty around the
we
temples.
Call it the Air Jordan.
Okay, well, I think basically I'm going to slap these two guys around a bit because I've been far, far too cheeky. At this point, now, I would like you both to take your positions at the machine, and I'm going to go up and have a chat to my wee pal, Derek. As I said, Mr. Lynch, fine employee of Funland, has helped me out with this one. Okay, Derek, give us some tips.
Okay, the trick here is to get in the opponent's slipstream right up behind the car to gain speed.
If you're behind, yeah.
That's right, if you're behind. Mm-hmm. And then you go on the inside lane and perhaps knock them out of control.
So that's it, it's that inside lane that's going to be important
that's
if you're behind.
Right, yeah.
Okay, thanks so much, Derek. Right, whoever is in the lead at the end of the second lap will go away with our final Games Master Golden Joystick then. Best of luck, Cecil, best of luck, Amar. Let's start the race. We're going to count in 3, 2, 1. We'll start off with Cecil. And off they go. It's Cecil in first position. He got the slightly better start there, but it's very, very close. So, yes, if we go to Amar's screen now, we can see Cecil's red car in front of him here. It's not a lot in. There's only a couple of seconds. OK, so Amar's a little bit behind Derek. What would you do if you were him?
That's right. He's got to try and stay, as I said earlier on, in the slipstream, cut the corners sharp, and catch up with him, basically.
OK, we're still with Amar Skinny. He's a little bit behind there. Cecil is tearing away. He's handling those curves fantastically. If we cut back now onto Cecil's screen just after he's through this bend, we can see the blue car in his rearview mirror at the top. Now, you can see Amar is catching up a little bit if he looks in his mirror, but that's probably just because Cecil was slowing down to take a corner there. Let's go back to Amar Skinny. He's catching right up, Derek.
Oh, yes, very close.
He's going for that inside, like you said. He's taking the inside there. That's Amar taking the lead. So let's go. Oh, no, he's still got the lead. It changed too quickly there for me, Derek.
That's
I didn't know what was happening. So it's still Amar in the lead, but still at Amar's now. Let's go back to Cecil's screen. You can see Amar in front of him. Now Cecil's going to have to do some of the slipstream stuff,
exactly.
Derek.
Right to the slipstream. He's got him again.
And he has on the inside once again.
Oh, he's lost it again.
Oh, he's lost it. This is changing more than the weather. Okay, so we're with Cecil just now. He is behind Amar. And he's off. Now he's going to go down to the lower screen here, Derek.
That's
what is this?
He's fallen off the mountain and onto another track, but he can catch up if he can drive fast enough.
Okay, but he will probably lose some time here.
Yes.
Okay, here he comes. He's back on the normal track. We can see right in front of him, there is Amar. So he hasn't lost that much time. He's been driving well, Derek.
That's right.
Okay. One of the computer control cars are in the pink, but he got past them easily. So it's still, we're still with Cecil. Amar is still ahead. We're on the second lap, about halfway through. Bit of a spin there from Cecil, that's not going to help him. Amar is still streaking ahead and he's probably about 2 or 3 seconds in the lead. Over to you, Derek.
Okay, here it's coming to the edge of the mountain here. Oh, he's doing well. Straight into the tunnel.
Took that well.
He needs critical skill of braking on the corners here.
This is it. He can't afford to put a foot on a pedal wrong now, Cecil. He's just behind him though. We're coming up. There's not much longer to go until we're at the end of the second lap. And they're just coming up there. You can see the checkpoint. That's the finishing line up there. It's still Amar. Amar takes the challenge! Okay. Now, Cecil, you had the lead earlier on, but you basically blew it, didn't you, mate?
Yeah, I was running on BR time. I don't know what happened here, man.
Well, it was that one stage where you fell off, didn't you? Tumbled into the lower screen.
Yeah, I just didn't know what was going on there. Yeah.
No.
Some you win, some you lose, eh?
I didn't realise you were a philosopher. Start calling you Cecil Sartre from now on, won't we? Okay, now, on to you, Amar. Was there ever any time where you thought that the challenge was in doubt?
No, never.
No?
No. Always the best man wins.
Uh-huh.
I was the best man on the day.
You certainly were, and you won.
That's right.
Some full of pocket philosophy from yourself as well.
That's right.
Anyway, well, two fine philosophers. Unfortunately, the joystick can only go to one of them, and indeed, the winner of the final Golden Games Master joystick is Amar. The final curtain crashing down on this fine piece of televisual action. Let's take one last look at a feature. This is the California-Nevada state border just outside of Las Vegas. Behind me, you can see Desperado, what's supposed to be the world's tallest, most frightening roller coaster. Am I scared? Yeah, right.
See, absolutely nothing to be scared of. It may have the kind of drops, banks and twists that separate normal punters from their most recent meals, but my blasé attitude is the result not just of being incredibly hard, but the fact that every inch of this ride has been designed and tested by computer. Aerodynamics in Utah are the people responsible for some of the world's most spectacular roller coaster rides, featuring corkscrews, boomerangs and hairpin bends that would have been downright rude without the computing power of their specially designed roller coaster software. The initial plan for a ride begins as a single line that defines the proposed path of the new coaster. Once this has been cooked up, dedicated software programs take over and calculate the speed of the vehicle and the various forces that the track, cars and, most importantly, the punters will be subjected to along every stage of the ride. Potential problems are identified by blokes rocking dangerously on chairs who can change the track accordingly. This period of testing and modification can take anything up to a year to complete. Once the basic outline of a track's been decided, other computer programs take over, adding the support structure that will be needed. Eventually, a detailed 3D image of the ride is produced, allowing the Arrow designers to ride the virtual coaster before the real one is even built. The software involved has created a revolution in trouser-tightening roller coaster design. But the biggest and baddest of them all is this, the Desperado. Okay, so it's 5,900 feet long, and yes, it does feature the single largest, fastest drop in roller coaster history, but secure in the knowledge that every nut and bolt involved had been painstakingly tested by the computers, it was no wonder that I was super cool.
4 G's of pressure, speeds of up to 95 miles an hour, and a 295-foot drop that I'm just coming up to. This is why, A, I'm not wearing my glasses, because I'd rather they weren't welded to my face by the time I got off, and B, I have not had any breakfast. I would just like to say at this point, Mum, I love you. Ah! Oh no! Oh no! Oh no! No! Jesus! No! Oh God! This is not funny! Oh God! No! No! Okay! That's okay. I think I'm past the worst. I think I'm past the worst. I hope the camera's worked. I hope the camera's worked because I'm not doing this again. No way.
And so, with my utter hardness proven once more in front of millions of viewers, I walked off into the horizon, hoping the baking desert sun would dry my pants before I hit the next town.
And sadly, that's it for this fine series. Heaven's been fun, but God's now getting on our case, and me and the girls are off for darker climes. Over the past few months, I hope you think we've had some laughter, we've had some tears, but most importantly, we've proved that playing video games is the best thing you can do in your spare time. Well, almost.
Goodbye, one and all.